So today we'll be talking about butterflies, and the topic is the introduction to butterflies. So this is a general webinar for the amateurs and not for the people who are already experts in the field. So I'm happy to deliver this webinar for you guys. So butterflies are insects basically, and all insects have six legs. So that is the basic qualification which an insect, when we call an organism as insect, it needs to have six legs. So there are many insects in the world. Actually, the number of insects on this earth are more than human beings, like the flies, weevils, bugs, crickets, moths, wasps, and butterflies. There are so many types of insects on this planet. So butterflies are one of the most beautiful insects on this planet. So why do we want to study or look at butterflies? First thing is, which everybody will say, is because I love seeing them. It gives me pleasure to take pictures or to just watch them. So watching butterflies, studying butterflies, photographing butterflies is an excellent hobby. It takes you out of your house and to the nature. And as butterflies are most colorful insects, the photographs also, they're like enchanting and mesmerizing. Butterflies are found everywhere except Antarctica. So you, wherever you are on this planet, you can always see butterflies, and you can always take pictures or chase them or observe them. And they have their own ecological importance in the food web on this planet. So what are butterflies? Butterflies are insects, as I said, has six legs. Butterflies have compound eyes. So compound eyes means, just look at me, I have got only four eyes. Okay, many of you will be having only two, but butterflies have got thousands of eyes or lenses in their eyes. Yes, I have only four lenses, you can see. So the thousands of lenses means they can see better than human beings, better than so many creatures on this planet. So what is the ability they have which we don't have? They have antenna, so they can smell and find direction. So that helps in migration, that helps in finding a mate, that helps in finding the food. They don't have ears. That means they can't hear. So when you are talking to your friend, telling about, you got a beautiful butterfly in front of you, you can shout and tell him, because butterflies can't hear. So butterflies won't run away from you when you are shouting. But if you make even a slightest movement, the butterflies get frightened and they will fly away from you. That means movement is something which they can see very easily because of their compound eyes. So the compound eyes are made up of many, many lenses. I think they have 3,000 lenses in each eye. And that is one reason why butterflies can see better than humans. So do they have some special capacity to see? We will see in one more slide. They also have proboscis. Proboscis is like the trunk of an elephant. So that is to drink liquid food or juice, you can say. So they don't eat solid food. Just like we drink fruit juice with straw, butterflies take nectar from flowers or water, like the fruit sap or water from the various sources. So when you are studying butterflies, you need to understand the basic butterfly morphology. Like they have got wings, like this, the upper one are the four wings here, and these are the hind wings. Okay, then this is the antenna. Okay, the eyes are here. Then they have got three pairs of legs, that means six legs total, and four wings, hind wings. And in some butterflies, the males and females are different. So there is a pouch of scent scale. So that means this is a male. So that means the males produce certain scent to attract the females. And this is the abdomen or the body, you can say. Okay, these are the wings to fly, this is the body, legs, and this is the thorax or chest, you can say. And this is the upper side. The previous slide was about the underside. So now you can see the abdomen here very clearly. And the legs are also named as four legs, mid legs, and hind legs. So these are four wings, these are hind wings. And the outer margin of wings is known as termen. And the apex here the front margin is called costa, and the middle part of each sail, each wing, the middle sail is known as sail. Okay. Okay, these are slightly different insects. Means there are so many insects, so butterflies are different. Structurally, they are like all other insects, but they can coil up their proboscis. Many insects can't coil up. Okay, moths also can do. And most important difference is the scales covering on the wings and the body. So these are the scales on the wings of a butterfly. So this is especially the great egg fly. And we click this with a mobile clip-on lens. So the, you can see the scales there. So these are the ones which protect the butterfly wings. Then what is the diversity of butterflies in India? We'll just have a look and not much detailed discussion. We have more than 1300 species of butterflies in India, whereas in the world we have 17,000 plus species of butterflies. One interesting thing is Mumbai city, which has got a national park in the middle, has got around 170 species of butterflies, whereas the entire United Kingdom has got only 155 species of butterflies. So it is interesting how India has got high diversity of butterflies compared to other countries. So what is the difference between a butterfly and a moth? Because many people get confused between moths and butterflies. They send photographs of moths and say, sir, what is this butterfly? What is the name of this butterfly? So here are some differences. The butterflies have antenna, which is club shaped. I have shown here various types of clubs and they are in the photo picture down. Whereas the antenna of moths are big, sometimes they are like combs. They are very huge antennas, because moths fly in the night and they need to find most of the things with smell. That's why they have big antenna. Then butterflies are generally diurnal. Diurnal means fly during the daytime, but moths generally fly in the nighttime. So there are exceptions. Some butterflies will fly in the evening, early morning. Some moths will fly in the daytime. Okay, there are some exceptions to prove the rule. Butterflies, while resting, they fold their wings on back or keep them flat. Whereas the moths keep the wings flat and the wings overlap each other and they are hooked also. So they can't take other positions. Okay, the butterflies have their eggs in various shapes. Here you can see one, this is an immigrant butterfly. Then there are different types. This is common rose egg. And the pupa is free hanging, means it just has a cord. So it's not hiding, it's not on the ground or it's not hiding in the leaf litter. And the caterpillars generally are not hairy and don't sting. Whereas moths have caterpillars which can sting, can cause irritation to you. And the pupa is enclosed in a cocoon. And these stay on the ground, they hide in the leaf litter or sometimes make a small web to hide. And the eggs are generally, moth eggs are generally round and flat. So these are the basic differences between butterflies and moths. And the butterfly wings, there are two types of colors on the wings. I have shown one slide in which the scales were shown. So one is like just like our colors, that is the paints or dyes or inks, you can say. So these are the colors from whichever angle you see, the butterfly wings will have the same color. Second is the structural color. Means if the angle of the light changes, you will see a different color. This is known as iridescence, like a rainbow. So these colors are seen in many butterflies, like blues, egg flies, blues, peacocks, royals, and so on. So I have just taken one example. I held this, I found this dead butterfly, great egg fly, took one wing and just moved the wing little by little and took various pictures. So you can see the variation in color, and in the last third image you can see how the color looked iridescent. So depending on the angle of light, the color change. So this is structural color. Also, there is something known as polarized iridescence, which is not visible to humans. Possibly it's not visible to other organisms except butterflies. And there is a recent research paper showing proving that there is polarized iridescence among butterflies, And these butterflies especially are found in dense forest. So these butterflies must be using these polarized iridescence to locate each other for mating, breeding purposes. So this is very important. So you can't see this. So what do butterflies eat? When I ask this question to anybody, the first answer comes is nectar or honey from flowers. Yes, that's true, but not all butterflies feed on nectar. There are many butterflies which never visit flowers. They eat something else, like the sap from rotten fruits or the minerals from wet soil, even from the shit or animal shit or urine. They take chemicals from plants like the Crotalaria and Heliotropium. Yes, it is true. Many butterflies feed on nectar because nectar has high content of sugar, carbohydrate, and gives them energy. Because see, if you consider butterfly as a small flying machine, they need fuel which has got high energy power, and which enables them to fly for longer distances for longer time. Because of their small body size, they can't take something which weighs the food, which is heavy food. They cannot take 5 grams of solid food. So the only food they have, the only choice they have is the liquid diet, which has got high energy content like sugar or carbohydrates. So we will see some videos in which I am trying to show you how butterflies feed on nectar. So first I see this video. In this video you can see a common mormon as you see with your eyes. And it's taking nectar. So this is what you see. You see a butterfly fluttering around a flower and you enjoy it because this is known as nectar. Okay. This is how you see it. Now just use a simple technology. We go slow motion and see the same butterfly taking nectar. And now you see how it's using its proboscis to get the nectar from each and every flower. The fluttering movement now changed and it's totally different. Okay. Now one more butterfly we will see as you see with your naked eyes and then in slow motion. This is a grass demon butterfly. See how it uses its proboscis and see the length of the proboscis. It is so long. So that is how it reaches the nectar. So it's like a fisherman's hook. It's throwing and reaching the nectar. So that's how the grass demon is nectaring. And now one more video. Now in slow motion, the same butterfly, same flowers. Now you can see how it is moving. So this is how the butterfly reaches out to the nectar, uses its proboscis to really probe the flowers and reach out to the depth of the flower where the nectar is stored by the flowers. You can see the proboscis is bifurcated here. So the butterfly is having problem in entering its proboscis into the flower. Okay, we can go to the next one. Now one more butterfly, this is known as Syke, and the Marathi name for this butterfly is Manmauji. See how many times this butterfly attempts to land on the flower. So, okay, you have to count when I start. It's like as if a drunk person is trying to stand still or reach to some place. So that's how this butterfly flies. So this is in slow motion and this butterfly is known as Syke. Really crazy fellow. So that's how butterflies take nectar. That's how they use their proboscis to reach out to the depths of the flower and get nectar. This is a lime butterfly feeding on wild zinnia. You can see this is a composite flower. It's composed of lot of, you know, many flowers. So butterflies love such flowers because they can get nectar from so many of them in one go. It's like wholesale deal for them. Then some butterflies feed on sap from rotten fruits. Like, and unfortunately, these butterflies were named by the Britishers as Nawabs and the Rajas. And these butterflies also feed on human excreta, animal shit, and urine, and dead crabs and dead animals. Possibly this is the reason why the Britishers named those as common Nawab and Nawabs and Rajas. They wanted to say these guys have bad habits. Okay, so this is common Nawab, Tawny Raja, Great Eggfly, Common Baron, and Bamboo Tree Frog. These are all feeding on rotten fruits. And then this blue oakleaf butterfly, underside looks like a dry leaf, and this is the upper side of the same butterfly. You can see the difference. Common evening brown feeding on papaya. This is pineapple, and this is custard apple. So they love these fruits. So let us see the blue oak leaf, how it looks from the underside and upper side, and how it enjoys the sap from rotten bananas. So this is the blue oak leaf butterfly, and it's a slow motion video. See the upper side. Okay, here we go. So there are other butterflies which feed on or certain chemicals. Rather, I will say that they need those chemicals, and these butterflies are males. These are the male butterflies, and they are all milkweed butterflies. Means their larval host plants are milkweeds. Especially the tigers, the crows, so the striped tiger, plain tiger, common Indian crow, glossy tiger, these are the butterflies. The males needs these chemicals. These chemicals are known as alkaloids. So, and these plants, this is a plant known as heliotropium, or Indian turnsole. So this is the Indian turnsole. So this plant causes itching if you try to touch it. So this plant has got these chemicals known as alkaloids or pyrrolizidine. This pyrrolizidine is used by the male butterflies to synthesize sex pheromones so that they become more sexy or more attractive or more bitter and more attracted to the females from females' point of view. That's why they feed on these chemicals and store these chemicals in their bodies. So there is one more plant which gives these chemicals, and that is known as Scrotellaria. This is a wild plant. These are wild plants in India. You can see here so many species: tigers here, blue tigers, glossy tigers, striped tiger. And we'll see one video how they try to derive these chemicals from the plant. The Crotalaria. These are the striped tigers, and you can see the pouch here, the scent pouch. That means both are males, and see they are rubbing. They are trying to injure the flower so that the chemicals ooze out, and they can sip those chemicals and store them. It's like a drug for them, and they are addicted. All the males are addicted to this drug, pyrrolizidine or alkaloids. So they need it. And if you have Crotalaria around your house, you will see lots of butterflies flocking on those plants. Okay. So you can see a lot of blue tigers on this Crotalaria. Here, there are no flowers. That means they are trying to get the chemicals from the leaves. And there are many butterflies which visit wet patches or muddy patches to get certain chemicals which they need, like the potassium and other chemicals. So that process is known as mud puddling. So during mud puddling, they take lot of liquid from the mud, keep the chemicals which they need for their body, and release the excess water immediately from the hind part of the abdomen. Okay, so these are the common gull butterflies. You can see here grass yellows, zebra butterfly, zebra blue butterfly, common gull, and common blue butterfly here. This is a blue mormon mud puddling, and this is cow dung slurry, and I'll try to show you, and we'll just forward so that we take minimum time. Okay, it's a slow motion video, so you may think that there is no motion happening, but there is a motion which you can't really feel. Now you could see how it is excreting the excess water from its abdomen. Okay, so it immediately excretes the excess water and just keeps what it needs, those particular chemicals which are needed for its physiological function. Okay, once more. So that's how the blue mormon takes the chemicals from cow dung or any type of animal shit or very muddy patches. Okay, it's a joy to see this happening. It was such a huge butterfly, and now it is the state butterfly of Maharashtra also. So let's try to understand butterflies. There are some interesting facts about butterflies, especially one I like to say is butterflies don't like roses and dahlias. Those are beautiful flowers, but they don't have nectar. So butterflies don't visit, really don't visit these flowers, though these flowers look really nice and beautiful and colorful. Many butterflies don't like nectar, as I just said. Many like to suck sap from animal seed. Then butterflies which feed on seed, they are named intentionally done possibly to insult the Indian royalty, and some are active in the evening. So let us have a look at the life cycle of butterflies. The life cycle of butterflies is completed in four stages. So the adult butterfly lays eggs, the caterpillar or larva emerges from eggs and goes on feeding spree, feeds and feeds till it becomes very fat and ultimately gets converted into pupa. Pupa hangs on till the time the weather is perfect for it, the butterfly to emerge. And inside the pupa, a lot of things happen, a lot of changes happen. You may not see anything from outside. And one day, the butterfly is ready to emerge and the butterfly comes out. So this process which is happening, the turmoil which is happening inside the pupa is known as metamorphosis. Okay, so a lot of things happen. So this is one example, the life cycle of common rose butterfly. This is the egg, this is the caterpillar, this is the pupa, and the adult butterfly. You can see in three stages, you can see the red color here, warning all the predators that this is poisonous butterfly. This is a poisonous butterfly, so don't play with it. That's the message. So common rose life cycle, we will see the life cycle of one. We'll just watch it on National Geography instead of trying to have my own video. I don't know whether it plays here. Okay, I think it is working. So this is a small video, only 2 minutes, and okay, this is the egg, and you can see the caterpillar becoming ready to emerge. And when the caterpillar emerges, the first thing it feeds on is the egg shell. So that's the breakfast. So it starts, the first meal of its life is nothing but the eggshell for the caterpillar. As soon as it comes out, it just, okay, it's finished the eggshell. So it starts feeding on the leaves of the plant, the same plant on which it takes birth, because the butterfly will lay eggs only on the plant which is the food of the caterpillar. So that is known as the larval host plant, LHP. So it just goes on feeding, and it has got no other purpose, no other work. Feeds and changes. Changing skin is known as molting. So it molts many times, at least four times. So this is molting, and four times, after molting four times, it becomes or gets converted into a pupa, which is a free hanging pupa, and just stays there till it's ready, till the butterfly is ready to emerge. Now the butterfly is ready to emerge as the metamorphosis is completed, and you can see head first and the antennas, and the butterfly hangs on to the empty pupa for some time. Proboscis gets ready, the wings open like the flags, unfurling of flags, and it pumps blood into the wings and tries flapping the wings. And oh, okay. Okay, let's look at the classification of butterflies. So butterflies are classified all around the world into six families. The Papilionidae, so these are the swallowtail butterflies. These are the most beautiful butterflies. And the Nymphalidae, the brush-footed butterflies like these, the plain tiger, and the Pieridae, which are known as yellows and whites. So one here, immigrant here, and Hesperides, skippers, as a red-eyed butterfly here, and Rhyodinidae, so the Judies and Lycaenidae are the blue butterflies. Okay, so this is the classification of butterflies across the world. This just look at swallowtails. They are the beautiful butterflies, and most of them have tails like these. That's why they are known as swallowtails. And sometimes they are very big, like the bird wings and blue mormon and the red ellen. These are very big butterflies and very beautiful butterflies. So there are few more swallowtails here. The common mormon looks like a common rose, then common blue bottle here, and lime butterfly. So the hind wing has a tail here. Then this just the tail is not visible. Then we have brush-footed butterflies. This is just a simple, I'm just giving few examples. I'm not talking too much about details. So some nymphalids are here, like the blue tiger. This one is the blue tiger, this is striped tiger, plain tiger, common Indian crow, gray pansy, and common Indian brown. So these are all brush-footed butterflies. Means their four legs have something like brush. So which helps them in identifying the food plant. Then Pieridae. So these are another group of butterflies, especially have got white color, yellow color, orange color, scarlet colors. These are beautiful butterflies, and these mostly love drier areas. So they sunny areas where there is more sunlight, the temperature is high. These are found, but of course there are many butterflies which are found in even dense forest, like the great orange tip, and some butterflies in only in very desert areas like the white arum. And they like damp patches because they need water. So few more pirates are here, like the grass yellows. This is the butterfly which is the commonest. Everybody has seen this butterfly since the childhood days. Then we have the common wanderers. You can see the sexual dimorphism, or the male and female are different. The psych butterfly, we saw the video, and the common immigrant. This is also one of the commonest butterflies in India, in cities especially, because the host plants were planted by governments. Then the Lycaenidae. Lycaenidae are also known as blues because the upper side is mostly the upper side of these butterflies is blue. That's why they are known as blues. And also many times the hind wing has got lobes, and some also have tails. So this is silver line butterfly, has got beautiful silver lines here. And one of the smallest butterflies in the world is Gradual. This is a peacock royal, a very beautiful butterfly. Then we have Rhyodinidae. This in southern India, we have only two species of these. Plum Judies, now divided into two species, otherwise there was only one species. And then in Himalayas, we have got Panchanillos. These are also Judies and comes in this family. What is the importance of butterflies? It has got ecosystem value. Means the ecosystem in the food web, it's very important. It serves as a food. And also food of many other species like the beetles, the drongos, the dragonflies, and spiders, and so on. They are indicators of the state of the environment. So if you study the diversity of butterflies and abundance of butterflies in a particular or in a given area, You can always say what is the state of the environment in that particular area. More the diversity, you can always say the habitat is good. Less the diversity, you can say this habitat is disturbed or destroyed or of a less quality. And this is, butterflies are very useful for cross pollination in flowers. Of course, they are not as useful as honeybees, but they are very useful. And butterflies form our natural heritage. So it's our duty that we protect them. They have an aesthetic value. They make the forest, they make the ecosystem beautiful. When you see butterflies in a particular area, you say that's a beautiful forest. They have got educational value in the sense, butterflies we can always use to teach school students, even citizens, about the importance of a forest. That's how we are using the butterfly garden in Mumbai in our conservation education center to really take around lots of people, hundreds of people, and talk about the environment using butterflies as a tool. They also have scientific value. So a lot of research is being done on butterflies, and we know many secrets of nature. A lot of secrets are coming out. And butterflies can create jobs. So there is a lot of butterfly tourism happening. People are going to Arunachal Pradesh. People are going to Amboli. People are going to Sikkim to see, just to see butterflies. And a lot of local communities are getting jobs. Also in some other countries, they sell these caterpillars. They sell the pupa for butterfly gardens in the airports and big cities around the world. So these pupa are, what they do is they have farms, like they have big gardens where they collect the caterpillars and not from forest, and they supply these pupa to various butterfly gardens. Then of course butterfly photography, many people do it and sell the high quality images and earn money. Who are the enemies of butterflies? Biggest enemy is human beings. And you can see the humans catching butterflies. And what do they do with the butterflies? They just make trophies. They make trophies like this and want to keep it in their houses. Also, they make specimen for research. These are trophies. This is specimen for research. So, you see, these people are showing their trophies. Such a beautiful, he has killed so many beautiful butterflies. See the Atlas moth and so beautiful butterflies here, the bird wings here. And he is so proudly displaying his collection, this boy also. So these are the people, that means the human beings. So they are the enemies of butterflies. See these trophies. So this online sale of rare butterflies happening even today. I took this snap today morning. These two butterflies, $450. They're selling. So this business is going on. That's the biggest threat to the butterflies. What are the bigger threats? Habitat destruction by humans. Humans want to have highways. Humans want to have dams, mines, everything. They just want to destroy the forests and get the money today. They are not bothered about the future. Humans use insecticides, pesticides, weedicides. These are the chemicals which kills everything in the habitat. They spray the weedicide for weeds, but those weeds are the food material or the love of those caterpillars. And those caterpillars die eventually. Then concretization in cities, 90% of Mumbai city, 70 to 90% of Mumbai city, the ground is already having concrete. And there is illegal trade, as I have shown in one slide, this one. The illegal sale of butterflies happening. Many Indian butterflies are there on many websites for sale. We don't know how they reach there. Then the natural enemies. The natural enemies are birds like the beaters and black crow. So butterflies is their natural food, but they are not responsible for destroying the butterflies. They just eat few butterflies. Then the natural enemies like the garden lizards. After we redeveloped the butterfly garden in Mumbai, in BNHS Conservation Education Center, the number of butterflies increased. It resulted into increasing the number of lizards. It resulted into increasing number of snakes, frogs, everything in the garden, and the ecosystem again flourished. Then there are ants which kill the butterfly caterpillars, butterfly larvae, even adult butterflies they kill, or dead butterflies they eat. Then we have spiders like the crab spiders. This is the crab spider here. This is the signature spider. So they catch with their own tricks. They hide in, crab spiders hide in flowers. Crab spiders may view webs and trap butterflies. Yeah, the giant wood spiders also, they view huge webs and trap butterflies. And these spiders also, you can see the red-eye butterfly being captured and eaten. So there are so many enemies for butterflies, except for the humans. All other enemies, they have their own strategies. The first strategy is to run away. So some butterflies have erratic flight, and they fly erratically. Then they camouflage, then they can frighten the enemy, become poisonous and show off that they are poisonous, and show that you are poisonous. That they try to show that they are poisonous. So we will take one by one. So when there is a threat to their life, what they do is they just fly very swiftly and also erratically. So the flight is so erratic, the predator can't chase it, and they just escape. So these are the sweeps and darts, and there are many nimpellids also which fly erratically, and really you can't chase them. Certain sweeps, they fly so fast you can't really chase with your eyes also. Camouflage. Look at this dry leaf, like butterfly. That's the blue oak leaf, and when it opens its wings, it's a beautiful blue color, as I have just shown in a video. So just imagine a butterfly chasing this blue, a black drongo or a beater chasing this beautiful blue color, and the butterfly flying erratically in the forest, and butterfly just perches on a tree trunk like this and just disappears, and the bird is searching for that blue color and can't find it. So that's the trick the butterflies have. Look at this beautiful white and orange color, and when it closes the wings, you can really see where the great orange tip has gone, just sitting on the mud. So this is a camouflage. There are many butterflies. On the upper side, they are so beautiful, brightly colored. On the underside, they are so dull and camouflaged with the environment. So what I tried, I just tried photographing blue oak leaf butterflies underside for 1 month. And this is how they change the underside coloration in the dry season form, that means in the summer. So they have got so much variation in the underside. So, but all look like dry leaves. Okay. But the upper side remains the same. This is the upper side. So the upper side remains same. Only underside, there's so much variation in. This is one species, just imagine all other species. Frighten the enemy. This is the caterpillar of the great orange tip butterfly. And when disturbed, it just stands up like this, and as if there is a small snake behind. This is the caterpillar. So it just tries to say, I am a little snake. So don't bother me, otherwise I am going to bite you. There is another trick which is there in swallowtails, that is known as osmeterium. This osmeterium is always hiding, but they just protrude it when they are threatened. It comes out, pops up, and it also releases a very bad odor at the same time. And you are not only enemies, even you get frightened when they take this out, this osmeterium. So this is a very good defense mechanism. There are many butterflies which are poisonous. Poisonous is not to humans, but to their predators. Or you can say they are distasteful. So how they become poisonous? So when they are in the caterpillar stage, they accumulate these poisons. They feed on poisonous plants like the calotropis, the oleander, and Aristolochia. For example, let us see this common rose. So the common rose caterpillars feed on Aristolochia leaves and collect the toxins in their body. So the butterfly becomes poisonous and saves itself from the predators. So the birds are, the predators get trained to see that the red colored butterflies are poisonous, and they won't attack these birds or these butterflies generally. But becoming poisonous is not sufficient. You have to show that you are poisonous. So the color is also important. And showing that even if you are not poisonous, you are trying to show that you are poisonous, that means you are mimicking some other butterfly. That is known as mimicry. And there is two type of mimicry in butterflies. One is Batesian, another is Mullerian. So Bates was a scientist and Muller was a scientist. These are two lepidopterists. And this mimicry is named after the two scientists, the great scientists. So in Batesian mimicry, what happens is the butterfly look and behave like a distasteful species. Okay, though it is not distasteful itself, it just tries to copy the behavior and color of a distasteful butterfly, and also fly like the distasteful butterfly. In Mullerian mimicry, what happens is distasteful species look and behave like other distasteful species. So poisonous, poisonous. So that means there will be a group of many poisonous butterflies looking like each other. So that helps in training or imprinting the predator's mind and predator's instinct so that the predators don't attack that particular type of butterflies. So they all mimic the colors and patterns and they form groups or rings. So we'll take some examples like the Batesian mimicry. Look at this. The plain tiger is poisonous, whereas the Danaid eggfly female is not poisonous. And generally mimicry helps the females because females have more threat and we want the females to survive because they need to lay eggs and they so that they can't fly away every time. So females generally show mimicry, not the males. So this plain tiger is is poisonous and is mimicked by Danaid eggfly, which is not poisonous. So the Danaid eggfly will even fly like the plain tiger butterfly. Now look at this striped tiger. This is a poisonous butterfly and a common farm fly, female. From the upper side, it looks like the striped tiger. From the underside, it looks like just like another palm fly. But okay. So that's how it tries to show that I am poisonous, though it is not poisonous. And then one example of Mullerian mimicry. Just look at all these are poisonous. Okay, the blue tiger, dark blue tiger, glassy tiger, nilgiri tiger. So these just look like each other. So thus offering protection to everybody. So that's the benefit. Then one more example is the crow, the common Indian crow, brown king crow, and double branded crow. These are all butterflies, distasteful or non-edible butterflies, you can see. So they also look like each other. So thus they offer protection to each other. And they all will be flying similarly in a similar fashion. They can be found in the same habitat. Even for us, it becomes very difficult to identify these three species from each other. So this is a butterfly garden in Mumbai, BNHS Butterfly Garden, where we work, I work, and Priyanka and Vedashini all work. This is the Conservation Education Center, and we have a butterfly garden here. So if you happen to be in Mumbai, please do visit. Okay. So something about butterfly migration. Only few slides. There can be an entire talk on butterfly migration. What I'm talking is just a few slides. So this is, when you say butterfly migration anywhere in the world, the best example is the monarch butterflies migration, because that is the epic migration. That is the migration which has been studied very widely, and that those butterflies migrate the longest distance as far as we know. So here is Canada, somewhere here, and here is Mexico, here down. So that from Canada to Mexico is 3,000 kilometers. So they migrate from year to year, and many generations, it needs many generations for them to complete the journey, and daughter or grandson and grandson will come back here. How they know where my grandfather, great-great-grandfather was there, we don't know how they know. But they have that imprinting and they have got the instinct that they migrate back to Canada. Again, their next generation migrates to Mexico. Okay, the seasonal migration is there. And in between is the entire United States. Okay, this is the United States. So they cross entire United States, and sometimes millions of butterflies are seen in United States, in Canada, in Mexico, all along the way. And there is a lot of research happening and already happened, and there's so much data available about the migration of monarch butterflies. So how do they do this study? What they do is they do tagging. This is known as tagging. This is just like the bindi or Indian ladies wear on their foreheads. So this is the bindi. You just have to put it on the sail. This is the sail of the hind wing, so the butterfly doesn't lose balance. You can see the size of monarch butterfly and the size of the tag. So this is how a butterfly is caught, and this is a self-adhesive tag. As soon as you put it, it sticks. Okay, and it won't come out. And there are examples that the same butterfly has come up, covered 3,000 kilometer distance. So this is how they catch the butterflies with specially designed butterfly nets. Of course, in India, you need permission to catch butterflies and any animal. So not for us, without permission. So what is the situation in India? We don't have very good data because we have not done tagging. I think somebody has done, but I couldn't find the data or any research paper about the tagging done in India and what were the outcomes. But some citizen science data has resulted into giving us information on how the butterflies migrate in India, especially the bigger one, bigger butterflies known as milkweeds, the blue tiger, dark blue tiger, common Indian crow, double banded crow, and crimson rose. These are the butterflies which migrate in India. There are other milkweeds also which migrate, but we have information about these. The crimson rose migrates from Sri Lanka to Tamil Nadu in huge numbers, and I have seen the migration here. Okay. Then this is the migration happening in South India especially. Oh, there's one more slide. But okay, this one is easy. So you can see this yellow arrows showing migration from Western Ghats to Eastern Ghats, and red arrows showing from Eastern Ghats to Western Ghats. So the yellow means pre-monsoon, because heavy monsoon, heavy rains, the butterflies can't tolerate so much humidity, and as there is no sunlight, it's very difficult for the butterflies to survive. So they migrate to areas where there is less rain and good sunlight. And when the rains recede, as soon as the monsoon is over, the butterflies come back to Western Ghats. That's the pattern which has emerged, and there are research papers. This is the same thing explained in another format. So sometimes what we see is butterflies congregating at some places. This one we have seen in Eur, and also we have seen in Sanjay Gandhi National Park or in Goregaon site. I have seen thousands of butterflies, two, three pigeons. And this is very important that we note congregations. So congregations are the days when butterflies get together. They form congregations, and possibly after the congregation, they start migrating. Somewhere else, we don't know about it. So we need to do tagging or use some technology so that we understand the butterfly migration in India better than what we know right now. So how do you attract butterflies? So if you want to attract butterflies to your house or to your housing society or to your garden, or try to create a butterfly garden, what do? The best thing is, and the most important thing is, you have to fulfill the needs of the butterflies. So what are the needs? So that means you need to understand the butterflies. For example, you need to provide nectar plants for butterflies for feeding, because they feed on nectar. Many butterflies feed on nectar. So providing nectar plants. Then providing larval host plants for laying eggs, because butterflies they have got their own selection of host plants on which they lay eggs. It's not that they just go and lay eggs on any plant. Like some species of moths will be doing, they will be laying eggs on wall, concrete, wherever they can lay. But for butterflies, it's not like that. Mostly they have their selection of hosts. So if you want to attract butterflies like a magnet, you need to provide all the things which butterflies need, and the butterflies will come to your place. But I won't discuss this much, because we have another webinar on basics of butterfly gardening on 24th April. So it's the same time as of today. So please attend that, and we will discuss only butterfly gardening in that webinar. So some certain good things are happening, and Maharashtra state was the first Indian state to have a state butterfly, and they selected the blue Mormon as the state butterfly of Maharashtra. This helps in creating public awareness or goodwill among the public about butterflies, and at least they discussed about butterflies, and now students are also getting information about what is the state butterfly in their books and everywhere. So there is something happening about butterflies. So when Maharashtra declared, the other states also started following, and Karnataka declared the southern birding as the state butterfly. And this is the largest butterfly found in India, southern birding, very beautiful butterfly. And of course, one more beautiful butterfly, Kerala decided to declare Malabar banded peacock as their state butterfly. And two more states followed. Tamil Nadu declared Tamil Yeoman, might be possibly because of the Tamil name, but this is also an endemic butterfly, and that's more important than anything. This is found only in South India. And Uttarakhand then declared the beautiful butterfly, common peacock, as the state butterfly of Uttarakhand. So we have five states which has got state butterflies declared. Other states haven't yet declared the state butterflies. So when you want to study butterflies, you need some good books. And I just have some books here. I'm just showing you the screenshots of their cover and who is the author. So this was the book which I loved so much. I think this is now out of print. This book is Bugia Niches, Where I Work, Bombay Natural History Society, The Book of Indian Butterflies by Isaacson. And now BNHS has published another book which has got information on 1,000 species of butterflies, color photographs of living specimen, not dead specimen. And this is the best book which we can refer. The previous book has got list about information about the larva rose plants. This book doesn't have. This is just an identification guide, not feed guide. Then we have butterfly books like one by Peter Spitlase. It's a nice book, A Naturalist Guide to the Butterflies of India. Then we have Butterflies of Peninsular India. This has got beautiful or ancillary information on natural history of butterflies. It doesn't have many species. I think it describes 80 species, but the book is very, very good. But it covers only 80 species. Then this is the book on which all books are actually based. This is Butterflies of the Indian Region by Winterbury. This was published by BNHS in 1954. And now some publisher in Delhi is just printing it. What we printed, you can see. This is one of the best books. The first book which gave color illustrations of so many species of butterflies in India. I think more than 800 species. This book, The Butterflies of Sikkim Himalaya, or the Sikkim, and their natural history by Meena Haribal, is one of the best books. There are information and photographs of 800 species, especially the specimen. So very nice book. I think this book also, somebody in Delhi is reprinting. Okay, so it's available. Okay, there's one book on butterflies of Western Ghats. This is an e-book written by me. And this has got information about 324 species of butterflies. And this is a free e-book and you can download it. This also has got list of larva rose plants, distribution of butterflies. And there is a chapter, full chapter on butterfly gardens. So this is a free e-book. So you can just download and read it. You can read it in your mobile or laptop or any smartphone. One of the best books I got is A Guide to the Butterflies of Western Ghats by Milind Bhakare and Hemant Oghle, Dr. Hemant Oghle. Dr. Milind Bhakare and Hemant Oghle. This book has got so many photographs of each species, the larval stages and more. Egg photographs of eggs, larvae, caterpillars or pupa, and the adults, the male, female, various forms, everything in photographs. This book has got thousands of photographs and one of the best books I have seen in my life. If you are a butterfly lover, you must have this book. If you especially are in South India. Okay, there are some books in regional languages. The book I wrote in 2012 is the Maharashtra Tripulpakare, the Butterflies of Maharashtra. It's got 216 species of Maharashtra and South India. It's a very nice book. If you are Maharashtrian and knows Marathi, you should buy this book. But there are other books in regional languages. You can see this book published by WWF, and when I bought it was costing 15 rupees. And now it's there in Marathi also, These Butterflies of India by Thomas Gay, Isaac Kemper and Jagdish Puneta. There are butterflies of Nepal, Goa, Genera, Tivash Nesar's book, Rahul Pratap Singh's book, so many books. And Sanjay Swan, this book of butterflies of Uttarakhand, butterflies of Narrow Hills, Pakke Tiger Reserve, and with Krishna Mekkulte and other co-authors, so many co-authors. These are very nice books, illustrated books. There is one book called Butterflies of Gujarat. I could not get the copy, or I would have put the cover photograph here, by Dr. Parasharya. It's a very nice book about Gujarat. And there are books in regional languages like Malayalam. There is one book on Tamil butterflies of Tamil Nadu. Some South Indian butterflies by Mundali Rajan. This book is also very nice. I have got a copy. This book, one more regional language guide. And there are a lot of internet sources for you. If you are internet freak or techno freak, you can just see this website. One of the best websites on butterflies of India is the I Found Butterflies, or Butterflies of India. So this is a very good butterfly website about butterflies managed by NCBS. So many species, has got photographs of eggs, larval host plants, caterpillars, pupa, everything. And people are contributing, a lot of people are contributing their information on this website, including me. I also contributed more than 1,000 photographs to this website. So you can use this website, you can contribute your information also. There is one more website known as flutters.org. This is also a very good website. not updated properly, but it's a very good website. I have also contributed lots of other things. Then there are Android apps nowadays, and people love downloading Android apps. The best Android app about Indian butterflies is this one, Indian Butterflies. So this works like Wikipedia, and I have contributed lots of images to this. And this is the best Android app if you really want to use any app. And it sends you a lot of information about butterflies. There are vernacular names of butterflies in Marathi, Bengali, Assamese, Malayalam, and Tamil in this app. There are other internet sources like Facebook. On Facebook, you can join these two groups, Butterflies of India and Butterfly India. There is one more group which recently started, Ask ID of Indian Butterflies. So if you want to know the name of a butterfly which you have photographed, you can post in that particular group, and your experts will guide you on what is the name of the species. So, and of course, here also, if you post, somebody will always give you information about the butterfly, especially the name of the species. Then internet resources, I already mentioned this ebook on Butterflies of Western Ghats. So you can download, you can just do a Google search, Butterflies of Western Ghats, second edition, and you will get the link. There is a synoptic catalog of the butterflies of India by Varshney and Smetasek, plus so many authors. So this gives you a checklist of scientific names of butterflies found in India, because there is a lot of confusion happening about the scientific names. And I found butterflies is using some different names than the conventional names. So the confusion, to avoid the confusion, we can use the names given here by Varshney and Smetasek. And I am using these names as standard. So coming towards the end, so these are the two rare butterflies I want to see in my life. That's the Bhutan Glory and Kesari Hind, and this has recently been photographed by many photographers in India, in Arunachal Pradesh, some in Manipur and other places. And there are a lot of, there are postage stamps released on these butterflies. This one is not an Indian stamp, this is an Indian stamp, but here are the Indian stamps. And the hobby which involves collecting stamps is known as philately. There are people who collect postage stamps only of butterflies, or only of moths, or only of birds. So there are a lot of people. So yeah, unfortunately, we don't have many butterfly stamps. These are a few, and two more here. Yeah, these are the endemic butterflies of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So that's about Indian butterflies. Okay, let me conclude the talk here by telling you information about the basic course in butterfly study. If you are really interested in butterflies and want to learn more about butterflies, you should join this course. This is a 6-month course which gives you, which has got 2 field visits, 1-day field visits, 2 field camps, that is 3 days each, 2 indoor sessions, that is inaugural session and wrap up session, and 6 months. And here is the fees mentioned. And I request you, if you are seriously interested, if you want to pursue your hobby, you should join this course. I'm there, and you will get a chance to meet experts during all these visits. Please stay home wherever you are. The weather is not right to venture out. Just look at these monarch butterflies and how they die en masse. Butterflies, when they are in the pupal stage, they know when to come out.